ben Biljamia. Welcome to Learn Arabic Online with Lubna Dumayan. Forming the present tense in Arabic is somewhat more involved than forming the past tense. Present tense verbs are conjugated using both prefixes and or suffixes, unlike the past tense, which requires only suffixes. There are not any distinct forms used to distinguish the simple present, the present continuous, or the present perfect as the case in English. There is only one form for the present tense, which is unusual for this language. And it comes with three moods, halat. A word that also means cases. So, whose forms are derived from the imperfective stem? Stem is the verb, for example, here, dakhala is the verb. This is the stem that we will be conjugating, the verb. So, we have the indicative mood, which is usually ending in u. المضارع, the present tense, المرفوع. المضارع, المرفوع, because of the dhamma. That's why it's called المرفوع, the indicative mood. The subjunctive mood, المضارع, المنصوب. المنصوب is usually ending in فتحة. And the jassive mood, المضارع المجزوم. Has a sukun in the end. Sukun. The indicative mood, المضارع المرفوع, is the default grammatical ending of the present tense. However, these endings depend on the particles that are placed before the conjugated verb. In this lesson, we will be discussing the imperfect indicative, المضارع المرفوع. The present tense or imperfect is used with actions that are still in progress, like I am eating. The eating action is not over yet. I'm still eating. I am reading. Or with repeated actions like things that you do every day or usually, like I work, I swim. If the statement is always true, or for general questions like do you want to dance, what do you want to eat, etc. Or giving directions or making suggestions like you could walk from here, for example. So every verb has stem. For example, here, the verb dakhala, it means to enter, and the verbal noun of dakhala, dukhul, entrance. So you will see the stem in each verb conjugated with a different pronoun. It's the one that I marked in blue. So for ana adkhulu, so the stem dakhala, we have the three radicals of this root dal, kha, lam. For ana, we borrow the A, the glottal stop Hamza, Alif with Fatha, and use it to conjugate the verb in the present tense for the first person, singular. Ana adkhulu. And since it's al-mudari' al-marfu', the indicative mood, you will see a dhamma at the end of the letter lam, the last radical. And sukun on top of the first radical, the dal, and dhamma on top of the middle radical. Why? I don't know. There is no rule for it. It's random. Don't be intimidated by making mistakes while learning the language. That's so normal. This is the only way for learning. So you will talk, you will make mistakes, you will be corrected, you will correct yourself, and or you will find out. It doesn't matter. So if we say that dukhul is the verbal noun and there is a dhamma on top of the kha, that's why, but it's not always the case. So ana adkhulu, anta tadkhulu. We have the ta, the prefix ta from ta, anta tadkhulu, and we have the stem, an intact stem, stem in all of them, because this is a sound verb, regular sound verb. Anti, we have and prefix and suffix together. Tadkhulina, the suffix ina comes with a long vowel, yeah, that's why it's preceded by a kasra. Tadkhulina, kasra under the last a radical of the roots. Huwa yadkhulu, the prefix ya. Hiya tadkhulu. Hiya and anta, they are similar. If you say just tadkhulu, you would not know if you are talking to the second person masculine anta or the third person feminine hiya. So you will have to specify. So anta tadkhulu, hiya tadkhulu. It's confusing. If you didn't give up learning Arabic up now, you're fine. So keep learning. Nahnu, we will use the prefix noon of nahnu. Nahnu nadkhulu. Antuma tadkhulani, ta as a prefix and ani referring to the dual feminine and the masculine for antuma. Huma yadkhulani with ya as a prefix and ani, and since we have a long vowel alif, it will be preceded by fatha to match it. Tadkhulani. For huma and antuma, huma feminine second person dual, and antuma second person masculine and feminine, they are similar. Antuma tadkhulani and huma tadkhulani. So here again you have to specify the subject. Antum tadkhuluna, here we have a ta as a prefix, and una is preceded by the dhamma to match the long vowel wow. Antunna, ta again, ta as a prefix, and nun. When you have a nun as a suffix, mostly it's preceded by sukun. Tadkhulna. Hum yadkhuluna is similar to antum. Hum, third person, masculine plural, just with a different prefix. Antum tadkhuluna. Hum yadkhuluna. Hunna. Hunna yadkhulna. It's like antunna. Hunna, third person, plural, feminine, just with different prefix. Antunna tadkhulna. Hunna yadkhulna. Just with noon and preceded by a sukun. Here we have another an example of doubled verb or geminate verb. عدة. عدة will be this term. عدة. It means to count. And the verbal noun of عدة, عد. عد. Counting. And the root is عين, دال, دال. We disjoint the doubled consonants. So we have عين, دال, دال. Let's see how are we going to conjugate it. So the stem عدة, we prefix it with the A from أنا, أنا, أعدو. This time we have a dhamma on top of the first radical and a dhamma on the last doubled radical because it is a المضارع المرفوع, the indicative mood. أنا أعد, I am counting or I count. أنت تعد, the prefix ت. أنت تعدين, again the same prefix with and the same suffix with the كسرة on the last radical because it's followed by a long vowel. يا هو يعد, هي تعد, نحن نعد, أنتما تعدان, هما يعدان, هما تعدان, أنتم تعدون, أنتن تعددن. Here we disjoined the doubled consonants. We used the three root letters. And it became like if we had a sound verb with three letters roots. So it sounds like a أنتن تدخلن, أنتن تعددن, with a sukun on the first radical, دم on the second, and sukun on the last radical. Because here it acts like the regular sound verb with three root letters. هم يعدون, so أنتم and هم, they are similar, just with different prefix. هم يعدون, هن and أنتن, they are similar. تعددن, هن يعددن, with different prefix. Hamzated verb. The hamzated verb that contains hamza on its roots. So, qara'a, qara'a, to read. Qira'a is the verbal noun, which means reading, and the root is qaf, ra, and hamza. So let's see how we're going to conjugate it. So we start with a, ana a, aqra'u. This time we have a fatha on top of the middle radical. Not like here. Here we have dhamma. It's random. أقرأ, again سكون on the first radical and الضمة at the end. أنا أقرأ, I am reading or I read. أنت تقرأ, we will follow the same pattern just with a different prefix. أنت تقرأ, أنت تقرأين. Since we have a kasra followed by a long vowel, yeah, so the hamza will change its chair from alif to yeah. to match the kasra and the long vowel. Taqra'ina. Huwa yaqra'u. Hiya taqra'u. They are similar. Anta, va, wa, hiya. Some repetitions in the conjugation table. Nahnu, easy, with noon. Naqra'u. Antuma taqra'ani. Since we have to use the suffix ani to refer the dual, and we already have an alif with hamza, so what do? We merge them. When we merge them, taqra'ani, taqra, we have a hamza and the long vowel alif and the noon, we merge them and it turns to the elongated alif, which we call alif madda, that carries a sign like a shadow of a flying bird. This is alif madda. Madda. Taqra'ani, and you elongate the sound. And huma yaqra'ani, for the dual it will be all same with the alif madda, elongated alif. And huma taqra'ani. Antum taqra'una. Taqra'una, here we can write it either this way with the hamza on top of the waw matching the dhamma, or we can write it on alif, taqra'una, because it's preceded by fatha. Either ways are correct. Antunna taqra'na. Here we have a sukun on top of hamza. Like I said, whenever a suffix is just a noon by itself, it's mostly preceded by a sukun. Taqra'na. Hum yaqra'una, again same thing. You can write a hamza on top of an alif, or well, matching the fatha or matching the dhamma, doesn't matter. Hunna yaqra'na, similar. Taqra'na, antunna, hunna yaqra'na. Assimilated verb that comes with a weak letter, like long vowel, the long vowel waw or ya. For here, waqafa, we have a long vowel. It's starting with a long vowel, the stem. So waqafa, waqafa, wuquf, verbal noun, wuquf. It means waqafa, to stop or to stand. And there is even a sign, traffic sign, qif. It means stop, qif. It's in the imperative tense. So here, as we see, the waw was omitted. So we will be working just with the qaf and fa, just with the second and third radical during the conjugation. So ana, again, same. It's always same prefix. Ana, a. This time we have a kasra on the second radical. Ana aqifu. But we always have that sign of al-mudari' al-marfu', the indicative mood, by dhamma, that little dhamma at the end. Ana aqifu. Anta taqifu. Anti taqifina. Huwa yaqifu. Hiya taqifu. Nahnu naqifu. Antuma taqifani, again, it's the ani, dual. Huma yaqifani, huma taqifani. Antum taqifuna, waw matching the dhamma. Antunna taqifna, the noon preceded by sukun, hum yaqifuna and hunna yaqifna. Many repetitions. Defective verb. Defective verb when we have a weak letter at the end of the root. Here we have the verb jara, jara, the verbal noun jari. Jara, it means to run. Jari, running. So the root is jim, ra, ya, because alif cannot be part of the root. Never ever. So weak letters may be waw or ya. So how are we going to conjugate this one? Again, same prefixes. Ana, aj, ajri. We have the sukun, like here and here, on the first radical. And here, because our last radical is ya, so it's preceded by a kasra to facilitate the pronunciation, ajri. And we won't mark the last radical with the dhamma, since it's a weak letter. It's acting like a long vowel. Ajri, ana, ajri, anta, tajri, following the same pattern. Anti, tajrina. So the ya is acting here as a regular suffix and as a part of the root, the third radical. Aj tajrina. Huwa yajri, hiya tajri, nahnu najri, antuma tajriyani, huma yajriyani, huma tajriyani, antum tajruna. Here we got rid of the ya. We just worked with the jim and ra. And since the suffix is waw noon, so we have to match it with a dhamma before it. That's why we got rid of the long vowel of the root, because ya and waw, it won't work together. Antunna tajrina, here we kept the ya since it's matching the kasra, tajrina, like here, it's same. And hum yajruna, like antum, hunna yajrina. So, antunna tajrina, anti tajrina. Again, another repetition. Hollow verb when there is a weak consonant in the middle, well or ya, the long vowels. Weak letters, we say weak letters because they may act as a long vowel or as regular consonants. So, nama is the stem. Nama, to sleep. The verbal noun, nom. So, the root is noon, since alif cannot be part of the root. So, let's extract it from the verbal noun. It's waw and mim. But here, we will be just working with the noon and the mim, and this is the stem. We will have the stem nama. Nama, to sleep. Noun, sleep. So here we will prefix it with alif. Ana anamu. Here we have the fatha because it's an elongated letter, na, na, anamu. That's why we have a fatha, because it's followed by a long vowel, alif. Anta, tanamu. Anti, tanamina. Here, the ina is mostly preceded by kasra. Huwa yanamu, hiya tanamu, nahnu nanamu, antuma tanamani. Huma yanamani, a fatha before the long vowel, alif, the suffix of the dual. Huma تنامني أنتم تنامون. The dhamma followed by the waw, the long vowel waw. The una is referring to أنتم. أنتن تنمن. Here we got rid of the long vowel. We use just the noon and the mim. It's hollow. There is an empty spot in the middle. And we have a sukun. But we kept the fatha though on the noon. Even if it's not followed by the long vowel alif. We kept the same rhyming. Tanamna and sukun because of the suffix noon. Tanamna. هم ينامون هن ينمن.